Good evening, everybody.
Beauty lies in imperfection. Well, you know, it can be a kind of source of inspiration, you know, imperfection. It kind of helps you, you know, relieve yourself from all the excess baggage which society kind of piles mile high in various places. It allows you to be authentic, true to yourself, and actually more like a child. And what's a child? A child is somebody, especially in the age group of 3 and 4, they're really cool, you know? So what do the Jesuits say? The Jesuits say, you give me a child of 7 and I'll tell you what kind of a man he'll be. And when you become a man like that, then effectively what you need to do is you start following all the principles which society has formed. Things about beauty, perfection, various rules, sequences like the Fibonacci. May not be the Fibonacci sequence, you might follow some other sequence. But then, you know, it just goes on. You follow the golden proportion. And that's where the critics actually kind of come in. Another brick in the wall. That's what we end up being, you know, if we just don't follow our heart. So effectively, what's the difference? Where does beauty, I mean, do you equate beauty with perfection? Or is it beauty, is beauty very objective and universal? I would rather beg to differ, you know. I would rather say beauty is rather very subjective and lies in the eye of the beholder. Look at Frank Zappa. He said what he said. And or even if you look at the Diesel ads, what do they say? Smart critiques, stupid creates. You know, this is a very nice ad. You know, it went something like, I kind of forget, but let me just try and get back to it. It's a Diesel ad which says, stupid has the balls and smart does nothing, something on those lines. Now, even if you get back to the unconventional looks, if you kind of followed all rules, you wouldn't have had somebody like Shah Rukh Khan or Amitabh Bachchan actually in the film industry. In his own words, he says, I'm ugly, unconventional, and not very chocolatey enough. Then you have the great artist, Vincent van Gogh, one of my favorites. He had a very childish style with broad strokes, rather bizarre. But still, if you kind of look at his work, it speaks a lot. Maybe not at that point of time. He may have been imperfect. But now when you look at it, he was rather different. Then you have the mavericks of design, the film industry, and you also have my favorite guy called James Dyson. It took him 15 years to come up with a cyclone vacuum cleaner. 15 years and 5,000 prototypes. Even a guy like Lucas took a very long time. He thought his Star Wars would have been a flop. And most of the guys agreed with him, except for Alan Ladd, who was the president then. And he said, it's going to make a great film. And you know all about Star Wars. Then the Empire Strikes Back. What do you want to become? A clone? A machinized clone? Or you want to be the cross-pollinators? A part of Han Solo's group. Somebody, you know, who kind of cross-pollinated from here and there and came up with a lot of other things. Or for the matter, if you look at the guy in the center, his name is Raymond Loewy, a prolific industrial designer who borrowed from all kinds of guys, especially Rudolf Nureyev, then your Arthur Conan Doyle, the guy who wrote Sherlock Holmes, and even Seurat and Pablo Picasso. Then we have the other guys from our ilk, like you've got Jan Kiplicki. Kiplicki's work, when he initially did, he built his first building when he was close to 45, 46. That was the media center at Lord's. They considered it a blob or a garden, but I think it was an idea ahead of its time. If you kind of look at it now, it's a monocoque shell construction, and that's where it came. Then you have our mavericks in sport, Tyson, Ganguly, McEnroe. Who can forget him? All these guys were great sportsmen, but what do you remember them for? More for the imperfect behavior, which was rather endearing. And then where does beauty lie? We are also concerned about our figures. But you tell me the difference. Now, you've got a prickly pear cacti, you've got a puncher, you've got a savaro. But all of us still want to look like the Barbie dolls. So where exactly does beauty lie? So that's something which you guys, I mean, which all of us have to kind of decide on. Then, as Anil spoke about Kintu Sokarai, what exactly is it? They're broken pieces of ceramic, which you kind of inlay with gold and silver, and you come up with something which is rather interesting. It's very much like us. Like if you went back to the old slide and you compare this one. And then the beauties, I mean, who've been eternal? My favorite, Audrey Hepburn. She looked as good now, at this age, she's passed away, than what she looked at when you were seeing Breakfast at Tiffany's or Judi Dench. I mean, they still are very nice. I mean, and why does one really need to hide your defects? I think this graphic speaks about it all. It's our beauty which is, I mean, you know, it's our perception which is flawed. I mean, beauty is something which is rather subjective. I mean, it lies in the eye of the beholder, whether you have curly hair, whether you have straight hair, whether what is the figure, 36, 26, 20, 36, I don't know. Whatever it is, I mean, you just go with it. As long as you're damn attractive, that says it all. I really don't know how perfect this presentation was, but I had a whale of a time making it. It was a little difficult with the 2020 thing. I'm not much into all these things, but I really enjoyed it. And it was a nice time to get back into academics and read about a few things. Thank you.